Hi everyone, Cafe Oikos welcomes you to its very first virtual talk. Thanks for joining us today. I'm Manini, one of the 5 co-organizers, and the others in the team are Anisha, Shishir, Ishika and Janvi. So just a quick introduction to what we do. Cafe Oikos is an ongoing series of talks that we conduct in different public spaces in Bangalore, and this is our 13th talk. We would like to thank Neelakini Foundation for their support and Current Conservation, who we collaborate with. Questions can be taken by the speaker after the talk. You can note them down and ask them in the chat box towards the end. We wanted to conduct today's talk because we felt the need to draw focus on this very complex issue of the fisheries. As thousands of livelihoods are at stake due to the lockdown, it is crucial that we understand this situation and make efforts to help the ones in need. Today we have with us Marianne Manuel. She is the Assistant Director of Dakshin Foundation. Dakshin is a non-profit working in different coastal states in mainland India and the islands on issues of natural resource management and fisher community rights. Currently, she's working closely with the director to coordinate Dakshin's lockdown response. In the pre-lockdown era, her research focused on issues of coastal governance in partnership with fisher unions and other support organizations. She also bakes the best banana bread ever. Thanks for joining us today, Marianne. Over to you.
So, hi, everyone. Thank you for logging in. I see there's a lot of people. No stress. So the topic of my talk today is Fish for Thought, how are India's fish workers coping during the lockdown? And before I get into the details, for those who've had a long day and would like the two-line or two-word summary in this case of the talk, the answer is not very well. So if you need to go, that's the talk in a nutshell. Dakshin is going to be raising funds for this, so stay tuned on our social media and you'll get more details. For those who have the time to stay on, just a quick background on the fishery sector in India. So in terms of numbers, active fishers in India are currently estimated to be about 3.7 billion people. But this does not include all the people who are involved in the allied fishing sector. So this includes fish vendors, people that work in ice plants, crew members on boats, and everyone along the different the supply chain of the country. And so we're talking about a lot of livelihoods and a lot of individuals that are dependent on this sector for their income. Fisheries also, the other thing you should know is that there's a huge diversity. So when you say fisheries, you're not talking about a homogenous group of craft, of gear, of methods of fishing, of species that are being caught. So the sector, if you look at it, there are traditional fishing communities and fishing castes that are part of the sector. There are also new entrants. And if you look at sort of the general categories of fisheries, you categorize them into mechanized, motorized, and non-motorized. Traditional fishing communities can largely be found in the motorized and non-motorized sector. Some of them are also part of the mechanized sector. But the mechanized sector also has a lot of non-fishers, non-traditional fishers who are part of this group. And it is what it sounds like. The mechanized sector, the boats are mechanized, the gear is mechanized. The motorized sector, the boats are working with an outboard motor. And with the non-motorized sector, there is no motor. And so it's the mechanized sector that is considered the industrial, commercial sector of India's fisheries that caters largely to export markets and also national markets. The motorized and non-motorized sector is a little bit mixed. So the motorized is contributing to local markets, state markets, other regional markets, and also to the export markets. It's not like they don't. And the non-motorized sector, again, is largely local. And both the motorized and non-motorized sectors actually have a huge role to play in the local community's access to fish as a source of protein. So that's also something to keep in mind as we think about the lockdown and the impacts of fishing not being one of the activities that has been practiced during this period. The other thing to think about between these sectors, as I said, is this term fish worker. So my title says, how are India's fish workers coping with the lockdown? Not India's fishers or India's fisher folk. Fish workers is the more politically correct term to use. Fisher folk, many groups and fish workers tend not to use this term for two reasons. One, fisher folk kind of gives you an impression of a group that's not modern, that's living in the past. It romanticizes the sector or the group in a sense that isn't always ideal. And fish worker, therefore, is a larger umbrella term that focuses on actually the work and the contribution of these individuals to the sector. So they are fish workers. And like I said, it includes all groups, not just fishers, but everyone who's involved in post-harvest and in the supply chain. So if you look at this photo, that's the diversity of people that we're talking about when we're looking at the term fish workers. So just again, some more background in terms of the demographics involved in these sectors. So the mechanized sector, as I said, it's a very commercial sector, and it is largely run by migrant labor. So you have individuals both from fishing communities and non-fishing communities that migrate to different harbors to work, to be a part of this mechanized sector, either as crew on boats, to work in ice factories, and different aspects of fisheries. And women also have a role to play in sorting and in sales in the mechanized sector. The role of women is much stronger in some sense when you look at the motorized and non-motorized sector, where women play a major role in all post-harvest activities, from cleaning, sorting, auctioning, selling the fish. So women are actually a very key part of small-scale fisheries and often also an invisible part. And the other thing also to keep in mind about the fishery sector is that from a governance point of view and from the point of view of focus and interest from the central government, the fishery sector has been marginalized historically by the fact that it's been subsumed under the Ministry of Agriculture. So it's always played second fiddle to the agriculture sector. So till about May 2019, we didn't have a ministry for fisheries. Fisheries was a department under the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. And so the focus and attention and the understanding of fisheries is not a comprehensive one at the center. Even today, it's not the Ministry of Fisheries, it's the Ministry of Fisheries, Animal Husbandry and Dairying. So it's important that the sector actually puts forth the nuances of what the ground is and engages with the department, with the ministry to make sure that there is that coherence between central state policy and what is working on the ground. And I also want to talk a little bit about what makes this group vulnerable. And I'm not talking about during COVID, but in general. A large part of the individuals, a large number of individuals working in fisheries are actually daily wage earners. So they're dependent on daily income to support themselves and to support their families. And there's a very obvious implication there for the lockdown period and what it means to have no fishing. But the other thing that I do want to highlight is the broader issues that are threatening fishing communities today. One is environmental degradation and also the dilution of environmental laws that has been happening over the last few years. If even during the lockdown, there has been modifications to the environment impact assessment notification. I won't go into all of these details, but I encourage you all to look these up. There are articles about all of this. The other is, of course, the focus on commodification and industrialization of the coast. Now, the coast has always been a place of trade, right? So we're not saying that the coast never had industry or never that there weren't multiple stakeholders operating out of coastal spaces. It's more about the shift in focus and the shift in power in recent years to prioritize industrial uses of the coast, tourism. There's a concept of the blue economy and how we can extract and how the coasts can contribute to the economy in a much more enhanced way than it supposedly is doing now. So if you look up Sagarmala, Swadesh Darshan, the Niti Aayog plans for the islands, you will see that fisheries is now just a very tiny part of the bigger picture of what is planned for coastal and marine ecosystems in India. And so all of these things already lent us a very precarious existence to the fishing community prior to this lockdown. And so whatever impacts we're seeing on the lockdown is actually just adding on top of existing issues. And so that's also something to just keep in mind. So let's look at the first lockdown period. So that's 24th March to 14th April and what, you know, happened during that time. And I'm going to focus on three groups right now. So one is, of course, our boat owners, then the fish vendors, which are largely, as I said, women, and the boat crew. So the crew that work on mechanized, in the mechanized sector. And I'm going to use them as an example of what is going on with migrant fish workers in general. So not just crew members, but others, but there will be an illustration. So looking at boat owners, again, like I said, the sector is not homogenous. You have these different categories. So let's look at motorized boat owners as an example of the more traditional fishing community and what's happening with them. So this is what a usual landing site would look like, right? It's busy. And what has happened during the lockdown is that, so while fish was considered an essential commodity and was part of that list of exempt supplies, fisheries were shut down in most places. Not necessarily on the first day. So on the first day, because the motorized sector is in more rural parts of India sometimes, those groups didn't get the message about the lockdown. So those groups went out fishing, they managed to sell their fish. The women who bought the fish and other traders were the ones who bore the brunt of economic loss on the first day, active loss, I'm saying, because they invested in fish, but they weren't able to sell them. But in the days since, fishers have not been able to go out to fish. So this is a quote from one of the fishers who got in touch with us very recently. So as he says, for nearly a month now, income from fishing has reduced drastically. Additionally, as a result of Corona, we were ordered not to go fishing by the police. We have no income, no food to feed ourselves and our family. We're hoping government and other authorities will come forward and help us. And that's what fishers are going through right now, a loss of livelihood and an inability to feed themselves and their families in many places. Mechanized boat owners, the impact was slightly different. So even those who came in on the 24th, on the 23rd, because these boats tend to go out on multi-day trips. So these multi-day trawlers returned after a week, 2 weeks of being out at sea to find harbors closed. No buyers, no ice factory workers supplying ice so that their fish could be frozen and sent to other markets. And essentially, you would have seen these images in the first few weeks in a lot of newspaper reports of fish being dumped because they had no way to offload their catch. And essentially, that means that these boat owners lost everything that they invested into that fishing trip. And similar to the motorized boat owners, they haven't been able to go out fishing since. With fisher women who are part of the sales post-harvest, they might either be buying fresh fish for the market, they might also be buying fish to dry it. There's again been slightly different impacts. On the first day, those who bought fish went to the markets. They found the markets closed. A lot of women tried to sell their fish on the roadside, door to door, but were stopped by police. We've heard of in Kakinada and Andhra Pradesh where policemen chased women and brutally and even beat them. And the horrifying part is that not police brutality, that's not the end of it. It is also the fact that their actions were cheered on by onlookers from neighboring buildings. And really, that's the mentality that this situation has instilled in people. So if we're looking at just some quotes to give you a sense of what's happening. So we have one from a fish vendor, fisherwoman from Karaikal, Alamelu, who says that my husband catches fish and I make money by selling them. But with the virus and subsequent lockdown, we are unable to do any sales for the last 10 days. We are generally scared to step out of our homes. We earn on a daily basis. We need to go to sea to earn. We need to sell fish daily to earn. The government must announce some measures for us in this regard. The other quote is from the secretary of a fisheries cooperative society in Vishakhapatnam. And this society has just gotten into the business of drying fish and sending it to other states based on orders. And so they had sent a supply, an order of fish to Tamil Nadu by train, but the day before the lockdown, on the 24th, and on the 25th, because of the lockdown measures, the transport was halted and the catch and the order was sent back. And it lay in the closed railway station in Visakhapatnam. The women weren't able to collect it, and essentially that entire catch rotted. And so they lost about 7 lakhs of rice. For both of these groups, those who have ration cards are getting relief from the government. It may be 1 to 10 kgs of rice, 2 to 10 kgs of rice, some dal. And in some states, it's also 1,000 rupees. But for a family of 4 or 5, that's really not going to last them the entire month. And it's not sufficient. But again, moving on to the third group, which is the migrant fish worker group. And this is actually the group that we have had the most experience working with during this lockdown period. So if any of you have been to a fishing harbor, you would have heard multiple languages being spoken around you. And that is because, as I said, the mechanized fishing sector is supported by migrants. You have people from coastal states, non-coastal states who come to work in this sector. From coastal states, they could still be from inland, you know, villages or districts. And so they work on the boats, they work on the ice plants, they work in multiple different ways. And so this is just an illustration of the cases that we've been working on and that we know of. And as you can see, for example, in Karnataka, you have migrants from Orissa, from Tamil Nadu, from Andhra Pradesh, and from Bihar. And like I said, this is just what we know because we've been engaged on these cases. This doesn't actually represent the majority of what this picture looks like. So I just want to play a video of the current situation in some of these harbors, because what has essentially happened to this migrant community that's harbor-based is that because of the sudden nature of the lockdown, this group found itself stuck at the harbor overnight. And the scale of the issue is not something that a single organization or even a group of organizations can solve. It is something that requires government action. So this is a video from Veravel Harbor in Gujarat, just so you get a sense of the scale of individuals and boats that I'm talking about. And also of the conditions of these workers. So these fish workers are either, in some states, they're living on the boats which are anchored in the harbor, and in other states, the boats are offshore. They're not even anchored at the harbor, and they have been provided with rations to keep them going during this period, the offshore boats. As you can see, whether you're offshore or you're at the harbor, all communities that we've been in touch with, all groups have complained about lack of enough food, lack of drinking water, no access to bathing and toilet facilities. So the group in Gujarat, for instance, also reached out to us talking about how they're essentially using dirty water for toilets because they've not been provided with water. Or better accommodation. This is a video from Mangalore. Again, just to give you a sense of the number of people that I'm talking about and why government action is... Sorry. So they're standing in queue to receive their meals. They're getting about 2 meals a day at the moment, rice and dal, essentially. So this is just in a nutshell, a quote from one of the crew members stranded in Veravel from Andhra Pradesh, who talks about what I just said, the lack of water, the lack of basic hygiene, and the fact that they're not getting a lot of attention from the government on this. And he reached out to us. He wanted us to publicize the issue so it would gain the attention of the Andhra Pradesh government. And essentially, he wants media to cover the issue. So they've... So for the interest of time, we're just going to move ahead. So who's been supporting these groups? In this period, we've actually seen a lot of alliances that you might not typically see otherwise. So in terms of support, there's relief work and there's advocacy support. So relief work is largely food and ration supply. And you've seen boat owners, fisheries associations stepping forward to support the crew members in the harbors. You've seen local government officials, district collectors, department, you know, the director of fisheries. You've seen NGOs all work together on this. Advocacy, the lead has really been taken by fish worker networks, and which is why, in a sense, having networks and being mobilized and collectivized is really important for groups like this. So the two fish worker, main fish worker networks are the National Fish Workers Forum and the National Platform for Small-Scale Fish Workers Inland. So these two platforms have been actively lobbying the government for measures to support the fishing communities. State-level unions and district-level unions have also been doing advocacy on issues within the state and in the district level. NGOs have been working with these groups to support them. And just to give you an example of, you know, sort of what this dialogue looks like between fishers and the state. So you had the lockdown that was announced on the 24th, and immediately you had these networks jump into action and send letters to the state highlighting the issues of marine and inland fish workers. And like I said, fisheries is a subsection of a ministry, right? So you do need networks to engage and point out the nuances that somebody sitting in Delhi is most likely going to miss. You had the ministry then refer back to these letters and ask states to look into the issue of fish workers and to submit those reports. To submit reports, we still don't have access to the reports, so we're unsure if those reports have been submitted, but the request was made. The NFF again followed up on the 28th, asking for clear guidelines, because generally just one sentence that says, yes, fisheries is allowed, doesn't actually take into account the details and the action plan that's required to make that a reality. Following that, on the 30th, you had the, you know, you had an interaction around relief for fishers. Till today, a no relief package has been announced for the fishing community. You finally had on 10th April, the Ministry of Home Affairs talk about marine fishing and the general operations of it and include that as one of the activities exempt. And you also had civil society, like 116 different experts signed an open petition to three different ministries asking them to take the issues of fish workers seriously. And so just getting into sort of what we've been doing in partnership with a lot of different people, and I want to stress the partnership, because all of us are stuck in our houses in Bangalore and other places. So we are not directly on the ground getting support to these communities. It is the networks that we are a part of and the new organizations that we have partnered with in this process that are doing a lot of the on-ground work. So I'm just going to turn on my lights because it's gotten a bit dark in here. So essentially, when the lockdown was announced, as I said, the fisher networks jumped into action. And from our side, one of the first steps was trying to understand the scale of the problem and what was needed, because with the lack of mobility, there's also a lack of being able to go there and assess things for yourself. And so a detailed needs assessment was required, and we had to figure out how us as an organization, and this is a position that many organizations are in, how can we, being stuck in our homes, actually be of some support? And that involved identifying organizations on the ground in these different locations who could do the work. It also meant building databases of government helplines and phone numbers so we could alert different authorities to the cases that were being raised to us by our fisher union partners in different states. And so essentially, we've been focusing on migrant issues, food and health, supporting the networks, as well as public outreach and fundraising. And this fundraising is really for really urgent requirements, trying to connect donors to these organizations on the ground to support them. And so currently we're tracking about 41 cases involving 14,500 migrant fish workers across 8 states, which brings me to the fact that the migrant fish worker issue is actually the most visible in some senses of what's happening in the fishing community right now. And that's really what unions are reaching and organizations are flagging with us, because the unions are handling local level advocacy and state advocacy themselves. So let's talk about what's happened, because it's already 6:26. Let's talk about the second lockdown and what's happened in this second phase, right? And what's changed really from the first phase. One of the changes that you can see in civil society is tired. They are stretched. They have been 24/7 working on these issues since the lockdown was announced on March 24th. And so now you can see that now with the extension of the lockdown, they're running out of funds, they're running out of stock. So organizations that we have reached out to on different sites earlier, when we reach out with new cases, they either there's a delay because they don't have money and they need to raise that money, or they've run out of supplies and need to find those stocks again. And another important conversation to have is really the mental health of relief workers, because as you engage in this process day in and day out, you have to make very tough calls. You know, you have to say things like, this group has had a meal today, so fine, that's not an urgent case. And making these sorts of decisions does take a toll on the mental health of people. And so that is a larger conversation that we need to be conscious about and need to be having. Luckily, you know, to sort of complement this, we can see a much more active engagement from the government. Fishing continues to be exempt from lockdown activities. The Fisheries Ministry, Animal Husbandry and Dairy Ministry, finally released detailed guidelines on 18th April for fisheries operations and how to go about doing that. States with migrant fish workers, the helplines, all of that is more accessible. There are still some helplines that aren't working, but they're definitely more responsive to the alert calls. They're also engaging more with civil society in their regions. And you've also seen some states launch apps for migrants that would get relief to migrants that are stranded outside the state. So these are all good indications, but there's a lot more that can be done. With the fish worker community, essentially, there is a gap between what the government is providing as relief, which is the inclusion of fishing as one of the activities that can be carried out, and this is what I mean by a lack of understanding about what's happening on the ground because of this lockdown period and the impact that it has had on communities. Communities are not in a position really to go into fishing, so. Looking at the two groups of boat owners, the small-scale fishing community in many places is willing to go fishing for, you can see them going fishing for household consumption. So it's a relief for them to be able to do that. But the level of protocols and precautions that have to take place for fish marketing and sales has seen the group really not want to engage with fishing for commerce. And this goes the same for the mechanized sector. The mechanized sector is dependent, like I said, on migrant labor, and migrants are tired. They are not physically or mentally in any position to restart fishing. And also the other complexity is that the entire supply chain needs to be activated for the mechanized sector to begin work. So it's not just about the boats going out fishing, but you need the ice plants to be working. You need the markets to be accessible. You need transport to the markets to be figured out. And so all of these pieces of the puzzle really need to be activated simultaneously if the mechanized sector is to re-engage with fishing. Women are left out of the conversation in most places. You know, as we talk about social distancing, when we talk about safe selling of fish, most of the propositions that have been put forth in the proposals are about online sales, is about the government possibly purchasing the fish, centralizing that, and then selling it through their government shops. So there is very little role actually for fisher women and fish vendors during the second lockdown in re-engaging with fisheries and earning an income. So I think that is why all groups have stuck to their original mandate of requiring a relief package. And the other reason, as I said, for relief is not just the worrying thing is that we're seeing a certain mentality of the fact that because fishing is lifted, we no longer need to provide relief to the community. So for example, the communities who were about to be moved to accommodation off the boats, that progress was rolled back because there was a impression that they would now restart with fishing, and so the government didn't need to support them anymore. And that's a really dangerous thought process, to think that now that fishing is allowed, the government can step back from its obligation and responsibility to this sector. And you also see it with, it's a concern for the general migrant sector as well, because intrastate movement of migrant workers to go to places of work is now been okayed. but facilitating their return home within the state is not part of those guidelines. And we're seeing these corresponding mirror developments across all sectors dealing with these issues. And so essentially, what do we need? What's next, right? In the next month, what does everyone need to focus on? One is the focus on migrants. And like I said, those are the cases that are coming to us as well. With the focus on migrants in the media and in a lot of civil society, you know, larger middleman civil society kind of organizations, there hasn't been enough attention on what communities back home in the villages are going through. And it's critical that we also look into that aspect because that community, as I said, is also dependent on daily wages and daily income. Not to say that we shouldn't continue support to migrant groups, because migrant fish workers and their problems have not improved in any way. And it's important that we keep supporting them through this. And so in the sense of immediate government response, we need to start working on sending migrants home and quarantining them closer to their homes. And in the interim, also improving their living conditions, because you saw the videos. That is, the second is relief package for workers, both because people have lost investments actively. They've invested in fishing, invested in trips. They've lost those investments. They've also not managed to earn a living for this entire duration. You need relief packages for fish workers, all those different groups that come under that category. And we also need to consciously think about fisherwomen and their role in fisheries and ensuring that they're included in the plans going forward. And this is also a longer term conversation, because the women in fisheries tend to be in a subcategory that is further, you know, marginalized within the sector. So how can you help, right? Just to wrap up, and so we can also get into questions, how can you help? Concretely, you can do three things. You can contribute. So identify an organization that you can contribute time, resources, or money to. Dakshin is going to be starting a fundraiser in partnership with partners in Orissa and Tamil Nadu to raise funds to support to get relief supplies to communities that we have identified in these villages that our partners have helped us identify. So that crowdfunding link the crowdfunding campaign is up, and we can share the link with you all. So please contribute and please share that link with as many people as you can. Thirdly is support small businesses and enterprises, especially now more than ever. It's key that we invest in smaller businesses that are struggling right now, like the fishing sector. Fish is safe. So if you can access fish, please buy it, because even pre-lockdown, sales of fish were really low and prices were falling, because there was a myth that you would catch COVID if you ate fish. So the other more general, broader thing is to stay informed and stay engaged, and to not be desensitized, by the level of reporting that some issues get. So there could be a tendency to say, okay, I've read this before, I've seen this before, this is a repeat. And you can get desensitized to the urgency of some problems, or you have a shifting baseline of what's important and what's urgent. Like I said, you had one meal a day, you're fine, but you're not, right? So it's really important to actively guard against getting desensitized to what is happening to communities around the country, and to also stay engaged in these larger linked conversations about what's happening to laws, what's happening to regulations, and kind of linking all of these together. They are all interconnected, right? Marine fisheries, as I said, is slowly being squeezed out of course. And so it's important to stay aware of these larger shifts in policy and in governance. So I will end there, but I do want to thank people. It's a long list, so their names are not here, but I want to thank everyone that's been working with Dakshin, so our own internal team, but as well as our friends from other conservation organizations that have been, you know, involved in the coordination work that we've been doing, all our partners that we've reached out to who are doing such amazing work on the ground. I also want to thank people who helped me actually create slides for this presentation, because there's not enough time to do these things. So just thank you to all of these people, and thanks for coming. I think at this point we'll just open it up for questions. It's 6:37, so I think I stuck to time.